Our series finale is today on chance, taking a chance with God. This has been a great series. I think lives have been changed, and this kind of the church has been moving, and people have really started. It's just to take some steps, and I think God really impacted some lives in this series, and I can't wait to hear what God has for us today. So I'm not gonna keep you much longer. So let me introduce our pastor, Tony Moore, and one of my best buddies. And he's gonna come up, and yes, he's my father-in-law.
I'm so glad you're here today. I don't feel any. No, really. It is a great day. So glad you're here today. And the last 2 weeks on Monday nights, we've been having a being upfront about being upfront class. And that's been a great time. And both weeks, I asked the people who were here to tell me something that they got out of the service the week before. And the feedback has been really encouraging. I do think this has been a good series. And Pastor Chris and Amber have really challenged us over the last couple of weeks. And so we're going to finish this up today. And you've been seeing the whole month the Monopoly motif. I assume you get this. It's Monopoly, right? That we're taking a chance. Not taking a chance, maybe in a little different way than Monopoly talks about it. But at the same time, we're taking a chance for our future, for what God has planned for us. So I thought today I might bring a chance card or two with me. Do you remember what they look like? They have question marks on them. If you played, has anybody never played Monopoly? I mean, you just never have played Monopoly? Everybody has played. How many of you hate it?
What? It takes too long.
I love it.
I'm not feeling like I have money.
I'm the best.
I like okay, it as long as I get to be the banker. No.
I am the best.
You're not.
I don't know. Whoever the banker is when I play Monopoly, I just don't trust them. There's too many, you know, under the table moves. That's why you're always the banker?
No.
Okay, so if you have a card, if you land on that question mark when you're playing the game Monopoly and you land on the question mark, you might get a card that says, advance to go, collect $200, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or you might get one that says, go back 3 spaces. Go back 3 spaces or advance to go. Which would you rather do? Good. Or you might get one that says, advance to the nearest railroad and pay the owner twice as much as he's entitled to. Or if it's unowned, buy it from the bank. Does that sound familiar? Pay somebody twice as much as they deserve? No. Never done that. Or you might get one that says, get out of jail free.
Yay!
You may keep this card until you need it, or you may trade it or sell it. Get out. I think I'll keep that one. Or go directly to jail. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. Everybody knows that card. That's the one that you just dread. You don't want that card. This might sound familiar. Pay a poor tax of $15. When have you ever got a $15 tax bill? Poor tax. $15. I'm just not going to say anything about that. When you're poor, you know, the less you have, the more everybody wants. That's just the way it is. Or take a walk on boardwalk.
Oh, okay.
So I guess from poor tax to the high life. Well, does that sound kind of like life, though? Yeah. I mean, all of those things kind of sound like we wake up in the morning, we're pretty sure you know, if I can just take one step today and get to Mediterranean Avenue, isn't that the first blue space on the board? I think it's Mediterranean. If I can just get there, that's my plan for today. I'm going to move from go to, I'm going to go all the way to Mediterranean Avenue, and I hope that works. I hope I don't trip on the way across that little line to the next block. But it seems like instead of just landing on the next block, so many times we land on the big question mark. Every day we wake up and there it is. Oh no, there's not just one choice, but I have decisions to make today, and I have a choice to make. Am I going to go forward, or am I going to go back three spaces? Am I going to get to advance to the railroad? Is it going to cost me? What is this day going to bring me? When I land on the question mark, is it going to send me forward or backwards? Will I experience good or bad? Is it going to cost me, or is it going to pay me? Is it going to be a day of promotion or a day of humiliation? And at the beginning of every day, like today, when you woke up, you had choices. What am I going to do with this day? What is this day going to bring? And what is God sending my way? What opportunities are there? And what am I going to make of them? I wonder if you know people, because I know it doesn't apply to any of us, but I wonder if you know people who, when they pull their chance card, it makes or breaks their day, just depending on what it says. I mean, it could be something little, like maybe they went to the mailbox and, I don't know, maybe they got a bill that they weren't expecting for $20, and having to pay $20 extra that you weren't expecting just ruined your day. Do you know people like this? Anybody? Okay. I mean, like the really manic responses, like over the top good or under the bottom bad. It, you know, whatever happens in this day, whatever this decision is, whatever this opportunity is that I'm facing, it's either going to, I'm going to be, just look at their Facebook status. Seriously. Just look at their Facebook status. Yeah. You'll know those people. Because it rained today, so it's just the worst day in the world because it rained. It rains every day, somewhere. Or either it's the best day I have ever lived because the sun shined today. You know, just that kind of extreme responses. I know that we know those people. So today I want to, when we're talking about the chances that we take for our future and to follow God's plan for our life, is there a middle ground? Is there some place we can go to where it's kind of even? Wouldn't that be nice? I mean, instead of today's the worst day of my life, tomorrow's the best day of my life, the next day it's just up and down and it's up and down. I heard somebody explain, you know, that that's what life is. Just life by itself is just a roller coaster. You know, one day's up, next day's down. That's just life. You're going to live that kind of life. And guess what? As a believer, Jesus said he came to give you abundant life. So abundant life means you have big ups and you have big downs. I don't know that that's necessarily true. I'm just saying that as a believer, I think our life is just like anybody else's. We face opportunities every day that we get to decide, is this going to be a good day or is this going to be a bad day? Is this opportunity going to make me or break me? But I think there is a middle ground we can find. I grew up in a household with two godly parents. And I think, in my opinion, there aren't two people that live out this middle ground better than they do. I sincerely believe that, you know, if something bad happened, I didn't see them go off the deep end. If something great happened, they were still just kind of mellow. because those things didn't determine their attitude. They didn't determine their future. Their attitude and their future was based on one thing, and that was their relationship with Jesus. And because they had a relationship with Jesus, all those other things were just didn't matter that much. The most important thing was their relationship with Jesus. Well, I want us to look at a scripture in Philippians chapter 4 today. The Apostle Paul writes about how he comes to this place, and I think it will help us. Because it's no secret that we face some really hard times. And, you know, maybe it's when the bank account's empty, or that wasn't me, was it? Maybe it's when the bank account is empty, or maybe it's a relationship that's broken, or some tragedy happens in your family or in your community that has the ability to turn you in a downward spiral. But Paul talks to us in Philippians chapter 4. And in this verse, he's specifically talking about possessions. And in verse 12, he says, Philippians 4:12, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Now, there's a phrase in here that I just never really paid much attention to until this week when I was reading over this again. And Paul says that I understand what it is to be poor. I understand what it is to have needs. I understand what it is to not have needs. I know what it's like to just be on top of the world and have all I need. But at the same time, I've had days when I had nothing. And if you look at Paul's life, you know that is true, where he had those experiences of being the apostle, the way we see him now, 2,000 years later, as the apostle. I mean, he's the man. But he also was imprisoned, he was shipwrecked, he was nearly drowned, he was bitten by a snake, he was beaten. Time after time, the bad things that happened to Paul seemed to overshadow the good things. But he said, this is the phrase that I noticed this week. He said, I've learned the secret of being content. Now, I don't think Paul was saying that the secret was being content. I think he was saying there's a secret to finding that place. Because I think we all know, I'd like to be content. I'd like for my life not to be so up and down. I would like for these bad things to quit dragging me down every other day while the good things lift me up every day. Can I find a middle ground somewhere? Well, what is that secret? well, let's go back to verse 4 in this chapter. And it's really simple, not hard, something we can all grasp. It's something we can all live out. It's just really not going to be that hard. And maybe not even that long. Verse 4, he says this. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Now, did you hear this recently? Like, last Sunday. Remember, Amber told us last week that in our times of pain, that if we can find a place to be joyful and to be thankful in the time of pain, because if we look at the outcome of the pain, it's always for our good. So Paul says that in this verse 4. He says, rejoice in the Lord always, and I'll say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all, for the Lord is near. Okay, so we've already seen in this verse him say what the secret is two times. And I wonder if you caught that. Because here's the secret. He says, rejoice in the Lord always, and then at the end he said, for the Lord is near. Rejoice in the Lord is near. This is really simple. The simple thing is that because you belong to Jesus, because he is first place in your life, and because he is the Lord of your life, then you have to understand that whatever things happen to you in this life, he's there with you in them. So rejoice in the Lord. He didn't say rejoice in the trial. He didn't say rejoice in the hard times. He didn't even say rejoice in the good times. He says rejoice in the Lord. So I wonder if we really practice this. Rejoice in the Lord. And he says it again. I'll say it again. Rejoice. So it must be kind of important. So since this is important, and Paul puts it in here, and it's an imperative statement to us that we should do, rejoice in the Lord. And he says, did you hear me? I'm going to say it again. Are you listening? Rejoice in the Lord. So, if the Lord is with us, and we spend our time with him in joy and rejoicing, I wonder if our time of rejoicing in the Lord would overflow into the rest of our circumstance. Do you think it might spill over into the rest of your day at work when you're working with people that you don't get along with? Or when your boss is on your back, or your employees won't do what you've asked them to do, or whatever circumstances. If you're going to work and you've already... Is this just too much to ask? Let me ask you a question. Is this too much to ask? That you would get up in the morning in time to spend, 5 minutes rejoicing in the Lord before you do the rest of your stuff for the day. 5 minutes? Anybody set your alarm clock 5 minutes early? I know some of you just get up before the chickens leave. But 5 minutes somewhere in the start of your day, rejoicing. Rejoicing. What does that even mean, rejoicing? Rejoicing means to put on a thankful heart and to find a place of joy about your relationship with him. If you're rejoicing in him, not rejoicing in the day, not rejoicing in the circumstance, rejoicing in the Lord. So my position is, Lord, I belong to you. Let me just say this to you. This is how I would rejoice in the Lord first thing in the morning. Lord, thank you that I'm yours. I thank you that I belong to you, that I wasn't left to my own devices. I don't have to make my own decisions today. I don't have to go through this day wondering what the outcome is going to be, but I belong to you today. And because I belong to you today, I know you're walking with me in this day. And through the rest of this day, you're in charge. If I make a decision today, let it be your decision. I'm rejoicing in everything that you've given me. Thank you that I can breathe. Thank you that I have food to eat. Thank you that I have friends or family around me. Whatever the blessings are that you have because he's blessed you with them, find a chance in the morning to say, Lord, I'm just going to rejoice in these. I promise you that if you start your day that way, your day will go very differently than it goes the way, you know, when the alarm clock goes off and you curse it and hit the snooze alarm and then you do it 6 more times. Or... don't even set an alarm clock and you just cover your head up because you don't want to get up and face the day. Or it's so depressing because yesterday was so bad and I don't even want to face today. If you wake up in the morning, just a minute, Lord, I'm yours. This day is yours. You know, my dad, I remember one time. It was one of those rainy days, one of the Saturdays that I hated when I was in middle school, because I hated rainy Saturdays when I had to get a haircut. It was just the worst day ever. Well, because one thing, I hated getting my haircut. For another thing, I had to get it cut the way he wanted it. Okay, we won't even talk about that. But so, you know, if you look at those pictures, that was not my idea. I'm just saying, when I was a teenager. Never mind about the pictures.
We saw them, Molly.
I forgot. I shouldn't have brought that up. Anyway, we went to the barbershop. We were living in Camden, and I can remember specifically, I could take you there today. We walked into the barbershop, and there's a drunk guy sitting there, drunk on Saturday morning. And, you know, they're all... kind of loud. The barbers are cutting hair and it's kind of full. And we walked in and somebody spoke to my dad when he came in and said something about how dreary the day was, how bad the weather was. And my dad says, well, never know. It might have been a day just like today when the psalmist wrote, this is the day the Lord has made. I'll rejoice and be glad in it. And I went, just wanting to hide. Daddy, really? In the barbershop? Drunk people? They're already having a day. They're already having a bad day. Now the preacher's here. But you know, I was in sixth grade. It's been a long time since I was in sixth grade. I was in sixth grade when that happened, and today, all these years later, I still remember it. I still remember his attitude, because he wasn't ashamed to rejoice in the Lord even when nobody else did. He wasn't ashamed to say, this is God's day, this is God's doing, God makes it rain. You want to complain about rain? Talk to him. Why don't you complain to his face instead of behind his back to me? No, he didn't say all that. Sorry, funny fair. So, the secret here is that we rejoice in our relationship with Jesus, that he's bought us, that he is in charge of our day, and whatever today is, I believe, Romans 8:28, that all things work together for good of those who love the Lord and who are called according to his purpose. I believe that verse is true. But Paul goes on and he says in verse 6, he says, so don't be anxious about anything. Easy to say, right? Don't be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. So it sounds to me like Paul is acknowledging this day might be really bad. This day has some potential to go down in the history books as the worst day ever. So you're going to have some needs. There are going to be some things that you would really like God to fix for you. So here's what you do. Don't be anxious about them. Don't worry about them. But do this. Pray. Bring your requests with your thanksgiving, with your rejoicing. He says, bring them and present them to God. Bring them and present them to God. So in the morning when you're having your rejoicing minute or hour, I know you can work that in, maybe, no pressure. But when you're having your rejoicing minute, include in that time not just rejoicing over your position in Christ, but rejoice in the fact that he's blessed you and thank him for what he's done, and at the same time bring to him all the things that you're really concerned about. Without being anxious, just kind of work through the anxiety somehow enough that you can say to God, God, I need you to meet these needs. Here are my requests. Here are the things that I feel deepest in my heart. And you know what? God knows them already. But I think it really helps us when we verbalize to God the deep needs that we have, the things that really burden us, the things that weigh us down, the things that maybe it isn't like the long list that we're going to be talking about in the next few weeks. Maybe it is those kind of even accusations from Satan that Kristen read the scripture about this morning. But whatever those things are, bring them unto the Lord with thanksgiving. So don't forget him. When the worries come, let that be an opportunity to turn it into prayer. With thanksgiving, turn it into prayer to the Lord. And it says this, when you do this, the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Now there's the phrase again. All of these things, remember, are in Christ, in God, to God, with God. Throughout these whole verses, you see this over and over again. And he says this, that the peace of God that transcends all understanding will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. So because, and you have to understand that this is the whole basis of this, is our relationship with him. So because I'm in Christ Jesus, when I bring my needs to God and I am thankful to him and I have this moment of rejoicing, then it says he will do this. He will give me peace that I don't even understand. Which is why I think the contentment comes from. The peace of God will come when you focus your attention instead of on the trial and on the trouble. If you focus your attention on him, he will bring you a peace that you don't even understand. Have you seen those people? Unlike, you know, the manic people, but there are the people who walk in the peace of God and they can't explain why. I can't tell you why I'm not worried. I can't tell you why I'm not upset. Like Chris was talking about his financial situation, and the guy asked him, why don't you ever worry about it? Well, I know that in in Chris's heart from time to time, he's wondering, okay, where's the money going to come from? But there's also a peace there that because I belong to Christ, because Chris has dedicated his life to him and because he's obedient to him, then there's a peace that comes that whatever the situation is, no matter how hard or how much I don't understand it, I know God's working it out. I know God is going to bring the answer. He's going to meet the needs. He's the one who's my provider. So this peace is going to come. It's one of the benefits that we have from our relationship in Christ Jesus. It's really the greatest one, that we're at peace with God. But he brings us peace that we don't even understand. And then verse 8, he says this, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, well, wait a minute, before we go there. Okay, you know, he's gonna talk here, give a list of things that you should think about that's going to affect your day. You can affect your day by the things that you put in your brain. So he's going to give us a list here. And I want you to think about the way you start your day already, the way you normally start a day, when you get up in the, if you get up at 4 or if you get up at noon, whatever time you get up, when you start your day, I'm not looking at anybody. There are some people who work like second shift who get to work, sleep late. Right? Anyway, however you start your day, think about these words and see if these words describe the thoughts that you put in your mind. Because some of you, the first thing that you think comes from CNN or, you know, Fox News or somewhere. And anyway, wherever you start your day, wherever the things that you put into your brain first, see if they match what Paul says we should do. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Not a whole lot of those, I think, would come from any of the news channels. So, there must be somewhere else that we get our thoughts to start our day besides there. I'm not saying don't watch the news. What I'm saying is don't let whatever the news is rule your day. I mean, I know people who just sit in front of the news channel all day long. I mean, it's always playing somewhere in the background or, you know, there it's just maybe not news. Some of it's talk radio or soap operas or whatever, cartoons, I don't know, whatever, and it's constantly there, and it's constantly filling your brain with thoughts, whether you realize that they're coming or not, they're coming. So this is our part, okay? We're in Christ Jesus, but we have a part to play in whether we're going to live in peace. And we live in peace by what we put into our brain, what thoughts we think. And he says that they should be these kind of thoughts. True, noble, right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, praiseworthy. Put those thoughts in your mind. And when those are the thoughts that you think, he says this. And whatever you have learned or received or heard from me, put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. The Prince of Peace, God, will come and rule your day in peace. You know it's true. You know you've had experiences where you filled your mind with other kinds of things that weren't from that list. And all day your heart was heavy. And all day your mind was dark or confused or, you know, just depends on what you're listening to. All day long your life is headed in a direction that's more like go straight to jail, do not pass go, do not collect $200 than it is like go take a walk on Boardwalk. When God has this plan for our peace, he says, when we think on these things, the God of peace will be with us. Didn't Jesus say it himself? Matthew, I think chapter 11, when Jesus said, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, learn of me. All of you who are tired, you're weary, you're worn out, you're just going around circles on the board, and you never get anywhere. He says, come to me and rest. Learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble in spirit. You'll find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus said that. Come walk with me. The God of peace is inviting us. Come walk with me in this day. And in this day, I want to give you this peace. I want your day to be productive. I want you to see how I can work through your life and how I can work on your behalf. I think what Pastor Chris and Amber have told us the last couple of weeks has just been, it's this simple reminder that regardless of whether there's joy or pain, regardless of whether you're headed forwards or backwards, or if life looks good or looks difficult, the bottom line is this, that God, if you belong to Him, if you're in Christ Jesus, God is working. God's at work in every circumstance, whether you see His finger in it or not. I promise you it is there. Whether you see His hand working on your behalf or you don't, He's there working. God has a purpose in everything that you face. Everything that you face, there's a purpose there. I don't believe one minute of our life is wasted. I don't believe one situation that we face is wasted. I think it's all there with a purpose. Now, do we see the purpose always fulfilled? No. But it's not God's fault, right? It's when we choose not to follow Him, or when we go in a way that we know isn't right, or we don't fill our mind with the things of the Spirit that He's called us to fill our minds with. So what I want to challenge you to do today, and as we wrap up this series, that we're the whole choices that we face when we're taking a chance, am I going the right direction or the wrong direction? The direction that we should always take is the direction that God is leading us. Because He has a plan. Thinking about a friend who feels like they're completely lost. And I had a conversation with him this week, and he says, my life has no meaning, my life has no purpose, I'm not going anywhere. And then I look at his life, and I look at the choices he's making, I look at the things he spends his time doing, the things that he fills his mind with, and none of them are godly. Not one of them. He's a believer, but he's not a follower. You know, your life can be better. Just coming to Jesus and saying, Jesus, I belong to you. I accept your gift of salvation isn't the stopping point. It gets you in the kingdom, but you can still live a miserable life belonging to Jesus if you make the wrong choices and if you don't follow His plan for you. So my challenge is that we find that we find a way to rejoice, that we find a way to fill our mind with good things, that we surround ourselves with the things that God has for us. And usually the first question I ask somebody if they feel like they're lost or they're stuck, the first thing I ask them is, where are you going? What is your purpose? What do you see as your big dream? What's down the road for you? And if they don't have anything, well, of course you're stuck. If there's nowhere you're heading, if you don't have a goal, if you're not headed somewhere, then how will you ever know if you get there? So it's in there. It's in you. Whatever the dream is that God put in you, that you were probably born with it. You didn't dream it up. I think God put it there before you were ever born. And whatever it is that's in you, when you follow that, you're going to find that the peace follows it. So here we are, challenged to have a goal, to have a dream, to have a purpose, and then to let God lead us in that direction.